All right, I'm going to do a video here exposing a particular pastor, if you will. His name's Kelly Sensenig, just to give you a little bit of a history of how I came to know this guy. Way back, I'm not even sure what the year was, probably about 2002 or so, 2003. It's when I really started to hear the truth. About 2001 is when I heard of the Bible version issue for the first time, but I really didn't really understand things, and you know, I just it was the beginning of studying research, and I was going to a small Baptist Bible building called Cornerstone Baptist Church, and it was there that I was really, really studying the Bible version issue in depth, and I actually had a chance to teach a Sunday school class on the Bible version issue. It was a couple week long, and I found out that the pastor there, Arnold Killinger, actually was not a King James Bible believer. I just assumed that if you were under the name Baptist, that you believed the King James Bible was God's Word and you didn't need to correct it. I soon found out that that was not true. And so I became kind of disillusioned with that place. They appointed a deacon named Chuck Taft, and he was NIV, very militantly, for the NIV, very much against the King James Bible, and he took me aside the one time and said that I was very dangerous. What I was speaking was very dangerous. And he definitely had some issues. But so I began to look for another church building to attend, and I saw this one advertised, Berean Bible Church, you know, and they had an internet ministry and everything else, and you can find that online. And they advertised as this King James only, you know, we are King James only, we believe the Bible and all this other stuff. And so I started going there, and Kelly Sensenig is the pastor. He's a man with the name of Kelly. But I started going there, and, you know, I had been using an NIV for many, many years, so I knew NIV readings very well. And back before I was saved, too, but I might add that, I was not saved when I was using these new versions, not because necessarily because of the new versions, it's just because I was a false convert. Okay, that's going to be important later on as we read this stuff here, this correspondence between me and him. So I noticed that he would read the King James Bible and he would say, now the Greek word here would be better translated as, and he would give another word. And he'd say, like in Revelation, it would say candlestick, and he'd say, actually the Greek word should be better translated as lampstand. And I'd go, in my mind, I'd say, but that's what the NIV says. And he'd go to some other place, the Greek word would be better translated, and he'd say the word. And I'd think in my mind, that's what the NIV reading is. And I had written a little booklet, and I gave him a copy. And the one time I went over to his house, and we sat down and we talked about this thing. And he basically was, you know, smirking about my conspiratorial types of leanings, you know, which I understood the satanic conspiracy at that time, so that really didn't faze me any. And he kept saying about the Greek, you know, the Greek, the Greek, the Greek. And I said, well, when you say the Greek, what are you referring to? And he said, well, the majority text, the majority text. I said, well, that's not the Textus Receptus. Okay, the Strong's Concordance text there, the Greek text, without going into a whole huge thing on this, because this is a, you know, a whole other issue. But the majority text there that you see in the Strong's Concordance is basically a blending of Alexandrian and Receptus types of readings. And it's therefore corrupt. Okay, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. So you have some major problems there. And of course, the other thing with Greek, this whole Greek thing, is the definition of Greek words. Many times you go to a lexicon that is written by unbelievers. You know, there's a lot of these guys that define Greek words, they're not even saved. So they might define a Greek word a totally different way, you know, bring it into English, and you know, it just, the whole thing of you've got to study the Greek, you get into all kinds of trouble, okay? All you really need is a King James Bible. You don't need this stuff over here, all these Greek texts. I have them, you know, and if I need to look stuff up or whatever else, I can go through the hassle of trying to find what is the word here and how's this work and that and all that. But, you know, why on earth would I waste time over here when God has given me His perfect word in English? You know, see, it's weird. And we're going to get into this as we go through this study. I'm going to show you the correspondence back and forth. his, first of all, his booklet, then my reply to him, and then his reply to me, and then my reply back, and then his final reply, and be interesting. And I'm doing this video for the younger Christians out there that are going to run into these hirelings that profess things that they don't really believe in. And you're going to see my original concerns with what he's written in here. The very last letter, he comes right out and says that the King James Bible is not perfect. Okay? He comes right out and changes the King James Bible while professing to be a King James Bible believing preacher. All right? I'm going to show you how to spot this. All right? My mentor, one of my mentors, and he's not a perfect man. I've talked about this in the past, but Dr. Peter Sturgis Ruckman, Peter S. Ruckman, down in Pensacola, Florida. Ruckman's got his issues. Everybody has their issues. Okay, no man is perfect. God won't allow that. Our perfect standard is right there, King James Bible. But Ruckman, one of the things that he will do occasionally is he will show correspondence between these scribes, if you will, like Jesus dealt with back in his day, and he will show you how they circumvent the thing of having an absolute authority. It goes back to the yea hath God so said society. You know, God hath said society. And, you know, and these guys will come out and they'll say, I believe the word of God is sufficient to lead us and instruct us in the ways of life. And they're holding the King James Bible. You think, oh, they mean the King James Bible. They don't mean it for 1 minute. They don't mean it for 1 second. And they don't mean the Greek text either. The word of God, to a lot of the scholars out there, the word of God is up here in their mind. Literally, they believe that they can be as gods, knowing good and evil. They have fallen for Satan's lie. And I'm going to show you that with this correspondence. Okay, so you can spot this thing. Because, you know, I had to learn the hard way. You know, I figured the guy was a Bible believer, and going to his Babel building there and then meeting with him in person, I soon found out, you know, that he's not a Bible believing Christian. All right. He might profess to be a Christian. He might profess to use the King James Bible and things and recommend the King James Bible. But there's a whole lot of problems there. So let's get into this study now. I'm going to show you this little booklet here. And I'm going to read everything that I have here. And I'm going to try to get through this as quickly as I can. Again, this is going to be a more detailed study. Some of my things, you know, I do the FAQs and it's, you know, 15 minutes or less. Some things I do sermons that are a lot of scripture. We go through a lot of verses in the Bible. Sure. And, you know, this study is going to be more of a how to spot a Bible perverter, somebody that does not believe in the Bible that they preach from. That's what this study is going to be. It's going to be very detailed. You want a lot of detail. I don't know what other word to use for it. This is the study. Okay. If you're looking for something quick to watch while you're downloading something offline or whatever, well, this is not going to be the study for you. Okay. This is going to be highly detailed. I recommend this for, you know, newer believers mainly that are really trying to understand how can somebody use a King James Bible but not really be a King James Bible believer. This is your study. And of course, if you're older too and you're, you know, in the faith, you can see this thing too. And this right here, this little booklet, is a lot more dangerous than some of the stuff that James White puts out and some of the other ultra heretics like that. You know, some of these guys that come out and they openly deny the King James Bible and they'll use the new versions, but they're not really perfect either, and they'll go to the Nestles and that, you know. This thing here is from a guy that claims to be a King James Bible believer. But I'm going to show you that that's not true. So here we have it. We have Inspiration, Fundamentalism, and Your Bible by Pastor Kelly Sensenig. Now, real quick, right off the bat here, just because you're a fundamentalist does not make you saved or just does not make you orthodox or whatever else. Okay, and orthodox in your belief. I don't mean Greek orthodox. I'm just saying in line with Scripture. Okay, fundamentalism is just the beginning. If you deny the fundamentals of the faith, you're not saved. I don't believe that for 1 minute. But to say I'm a fundamentalist, therefore I'm sound scripturally. Oh, not so. There have been a lot of fundamentalists that are quite heretical. All right, so don't fall for that either. A lot of these guys, they'll just label their stuff, they'll stamp it fundamentalist, you know, and it's like, oh, don't speak against the fundamentalist here, you know. All right, having said that, let's get into this thing here. I'm going to be reading it, and just occasionally I'll pause, and you'll see my highlighting in this little booklet here, and then I don't think I have any in his actual letter, the correspondence back and forth. Here we go. Inspiration, Fundamentalism, and Your Bible by Pastor Kelly Sensenig, the original manuscripts. I've sat on many ordination councils throughout the years and have heard the standard answer regarding Bible inspiration. When we are discussing bibliology, the young men being ordained for ministry will often say, I believe that God has inspired His Word in the original manuscripts. However, I've been noticing that the young men often leave the council of preachers hanging with this statement. Okay, now right off the bat, you see capitalizing the W on Word. Now, we get into this thing, and I argue with it, with this Kelly Sensenig on this point. And my standard is King James Bible. Now, the King James Bible, there are only seven references to capital W, Word of God. And each time it's a reference to Jesus Christ. All right? It is a name, the Word of God. It's one of Jesus' titles. That's why I never, ever, ever, whenever you see written word, it's always a lowercase w. There's supposed to be a distinction there. All right? It's a very important distinction. Because a lot of these new version people will actually capitalize W and they'll say, I believe in the perfect capital W Word of God. And all that those liars are doing is they're saying, I believe that Jesus Christ is perfect. But they don't believe in any perfect written standard. See? That's very important to remember. And we're going to see that that's in fact what he is saying. He denies it, but later on he proves it with what he's saying. Okay, continuing, it says, in fact, on one occasion before we were finished interviewing one young man, I asked, do you believe that the Bible you hold in your hand is also the preserved, inspired, and inerrant Word of God? Can you hold it up to your people and say that it is God's Word, God's words, you're going to see this throughout this thing, and God's mind regarding doctrine, holiness, and is the absolute standard of truth? The prospective young preachers always answer the question in the affirmative, yes. But why does an ordinational council need to ask this question today? Why must we probe to get the answer? I believe it's because of what many Bible colleges and seminaries are teaching the young men today. I believe it's because of the many books that are being written on the issue of manuscripts that breed confusion in the minds of our younger generation and muddy the waters about inspiration. Yes, the autographs are inspired, but the copies of the original documents are also inspired today, which we possess and reflect, and which are reflected in our Bibles. And you're going to see in this whole booklet, he never clarifies the King James and the King James only and not the other manuscripts. Or not the other versions, excuse me. Manuscripts too, but not the other versions. He never clarifies it. In fact, he pokes fun at the King James Bible a couple times. And you know, he has written articles defending the King James Bible and he stands for the King James Bible. But you see, he's afraid to line himself up with weirdos like myself, weirdos like Sam Gipp or Gail Ripplinger or Peter Ruckman or David Daniels from Chick Publications or other weirdos like that that say, this book is all that you need. You don't need to mess around with Greek and Hebrew. Okay? That's what's going on. And I'm going to prove that as we continue. Next page. By the way, no person knows what the originals looked like. We don't possess them today. Our faith and confidence is in the transmission process and God's providence in preserving His inspired Word and words for us. This is a matter of biblical and historical facts, but it's also a matter that pertains to faith. Facts and faith work together when coming to the conclusion that God's Word, which we hold in our hands today, is inspired and that we can have complete confidence in it. Now, according to the standards of the King James Bible, when you capitalize the Word, that's a reference to Jesus Christ. I can't hold Jesus Christ in my hand today. He holds me in His hand. And by the way, let me say this before I continue. I left this heretical cult here of Kelly Sensenig's little organization there. And it's 501c3, of course. And I remember going to it back then and he made a comment the one time about some legislation. He said, we could lose our tax-exempt status. And at the time, I didn't even understand what that meant. I've since come to understand what that means, but again, another issue. It's a government church, in other words, as are all 501c3 corporations. They're under the IRS tax code. They are limited in what they can say. They can't tell you who to vote for or whatever else. They are controlled. But sadly, unfortunately, my parents now, Mel and Pauline Denlinger, are actually going to this cult sitting under this guy. And they were the ones that sent me this because I said, he doesn't believe the King James Bible. And so they sent me this thing. And so, yeah, I still have a personal tie into this whole situation. That's why, again, I'm going after this thing. And to warn people out there, do not attend this guy's little Babel building there. He's not telling the truth. He's a lying hypocrite, and you're going to see that as we continue. But he says here, let's continue to be Bible believers. Although we do not claim that any specific text type or Bible translation is inspired in the same manner as the autographs, 2 Peter 1:21, we should never doubt that God has preserved His Word and words for us today, and that we can have complete confidence and assurance we have God's inspired, inerrant, and infallible truth, which is found in the Word of God. Again, and you see people say, he's capitalizing the W on word, and he's meaning the written word. Don't make a big issue of it. Yeah, but I'm going to show you later on, he doesn't believe it. Even if you want to make this capital W the written word of God, even if you want to make it this book right here or any other translation, he doesn't believe it. You see, if this is the inspired, inerrant, infallible word of God, you can't correct it. There can be no place in it if it's inspired, infallible, inerrant. Infallible means it's perfect. There's no fallacy in it. There's no lies in it. Inerrant, there's no errors. If it's inspired, God has breathed into it. It's a living book. So if you are calling this translation God's inspired, infallible, inerrant word, then you can't come out and say, but actually it should be better translated this way, and it should be better translated that way, and that shouldn't be in here, and this shouldn't be in there. You can't do that. Unless you're smarter than God, which I think somebody believes that way. I won't mention any names. Don't want to embarrass anybody. Yeah, let's continue. This is because our Bible reflects the original documents and can be trusted as a worthy replication of the autographs. To reduce inspiration to only the original autographs and not the copies of the autographs breeds confusion in the minds of many people regarding the Bible they possess and use today. Again, he's not clarifying which Bible. In this study, I want to clear up some things on the matter of Bible preservation, inspiration in the Bible that we use for our preaching, teaching, learning, and devotional life. As fellow fundamentalists, we must band together and reconfirm our belief in the Bible that we have today and stop hiding behind scholarly jargon, which he does, statements found in books, and jettisoning our faith in the Bibles we possess today. We might disagree on some of the particulars about manuscript evidence and, look at this, even on Bible translations. Uh-oh. But if we don't believe that God has preserved His Word and words, then we are nothing but a modernist, liberal, and Bible rejecter. So we can differ on Bible translations and still be in agreement. I don't think so. Okay? And by the way, this right here we have these two, are Textus Receptus. This one's Receptus, and the Hebrew, Masoretic Hebrew. Okay, that's what these are. These ones right here are all Nesselaland texts. Okay, 25th, 27th, 28th is what you have there. They're not the same thing. All right, this one here comes from Antioch, the received text. This one comes from Alexandria, if you don't know about this issue. This one is used by the Vatican. You say, I don't believe it. You know, I really enjoy it when people say that to me. They say, you can't prove that. You can't prove it. Okay, here we have Nesselaland, 27th edition. And I've showed this in other studies. I'll show it one more time. Introduction. The text shared by these two editions was adopted internationally by Bible societies, and following an agreement between the Vatican and the United Bible Societies, it has reserved as the basis for new translations and for revisions made under their supervision. there, in other words, the Vatican. Okay? And if that's not enough for you, how about this name right here? Carlo Maria is what the M stands for, Martini, a Jesuit cardinal. He's dead and in hell right now. You know? So this is the text that the Vatican uses. Now, if you get your Bible from here, NASV, ESV, you know, NIV, all the other junk, RSV, NRSV, whatever, if that's where your Bible comes from, you're yoked up to the Vatican. The Vatican never has produced one translation from the Receptus, the Textus Receptus, not one. Okay? That's important to remember. But let's continue. A fundamentalist Bible position. All non-liberal Bible-believing and fundamental Christians agree that the original manuscripts were inspired and without error. This is why we hear many Christians make the claim that God's Word is preserved, inspired, and inerrant in the original manuscripts. This is a common statement in most doctrinal statements and theology books today that deal with the subject of bibliology. However, where does this leave us today, and what do we possess today? Is God's Word and truth no longer preserved, inspired, and inerrant? Have the words that God originally gave been forever lost with the passing away of the originals? Can we no longer make any claim that God's Word is preserved and remains intact and pure, inspired, breathed out by God? Again, that's a false thing there. Inspired, inspiration, is breathed in. That's breathing it in. Expiration is when you breathe out. So again, this a new version, little thing here, little jab there. Inerrant, without error, and infallible, incapable of error. I've never heard any fundamentalist stand up holding the Bible in hand, look at this, whether it's the King James Version, American Standard Version, or some other Bible version, and say, this is not God's Word. It no longer represents the original manuscripts and is no longer preserved for us today. We can no longer believe that it's inspired, inerrant, infallible, and trustworthy. We can no longer believe what it says. Here's the danger with this whole thing. This is why this book is far more dangerous than stuff that James White writes. Because he is literally saying, if you use an American Standard Version, he lists it there, or some other Bible version. I just showed you the quote. If you use that, as long as you believe that it's the inspired Word of God, that's all that matters. Let's not fight about it. If you're a fundamentalist and a New Version user, and you hold it up and you say, I believe that this is God's inspired word. That it becomes God's inspired word automatically because of your belief. You see the danger. Yea, hath God said. It's not the King James Bible is God's word for the English speaking people. The others are satanic. Oh, no, no, no. The King James, if that's what you prefer, or if you prefer the American Standard Version or some other Bible translation, as long as you're a fundamentalist and as long as you believe it's inspired, it is. Never mind the fact that the American Standard Version or the other Bible versions, because the other Bible versions, you know, unless you go back to something pre-King James, which they have their issues too, the Geneva or the Bishop's Bible or things like that, Tyndale, you know, those are Receptus Bibles, though, you know, I'll grant them that much. But, you know, if you go with anything other than a King James Bible in our modern world, even the New King James, is blending the two, is what the New King James does. They'll use a lot of the Alexandrian type readings, and you look at the footnotes and they'll say, NU omits this or whatever, you know, and they're talking about the Nestle text or the United Bible Society text. So again, New King James is no good. But if you use anything other than the King James Bible in your preaching and teaching, I don't care how much you think it's inspired, if it comes from the corrupt source, it can't be God's inspired word. God did not inspire both of these. They're not both inspired. This is the corrupt one over here, the Alexandrian. This is the one that's preserved. So how can you say it doesn't matter what Bible translation you use? If you believe it's inspired, it's inspired. Continuing. Of course, we would be apostate if we did not believe that God has preserved, inspired, and kept His Word and words from radical error and corruption. So, you know, minor errors, as long as they're not radical errors, we're okay. We might we might as well choose or close down all of our churches. Amen. Why don't you do that? And stop being a Christian since we could not believe anything that the Bible actually says. See, again, over here, you can differ on Bible translations. That's multiple Bibles. Down here, you can use King James, American Standard, or some other Bible version. That's multiple translations. And then you flip over to here and you say the definitive article before a singular word, the Bible. And then, you know, I'm referring to a single thing, singular word there, the Bible, but it actually means multiple contradicting translations. Continuing. And yet some of the books being written today on the subject of Bible manuscripts and inspiration suggest that the Bibles, goes back to the plural, we possess today are second rate when it comes to being inspired, and many are redefining inspiration as only applicable to the Bible's concepts or doctrines, but not to its words. Why not capitalize it? Okay. Regardless of what position one holds regarding the family of manuscripts, so it doesn't matter, you know, whatever, we must agree as Bible-believing fundamentalists that God's word is still true. Okay. It doesn't matter. You know, you can be Alexandrian, you can be Receptus, you can use whatever you want, whatever translation you want, but we have to agree that God's word is still true. Yeah, and you can also go, welcome to the rubber room. Got another nut for the nut farm. We must believe that the 5,656 manuscript copies and overwhelming similarities, gotta love that little ecumenical thing there, overwhelming similarities, between these surviving manuscripts in spite of a small percentage of variant readings. Let's just, you know, it doesn't matter when God says about not one word, not one jot, one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Don't take away from one word. Don't mess with the Bible. You know, all that, we'll just eliminate what the Lord says, and we can agree to disagree over small inconsistencies. And you study the differences between the different versions. These new versions are obviously satanic. I mean, you know, the King James Bible says God was manifest in the flesh. The new versions say he who appeared in a body or something. That's a huge doctrinal difference. You know, they take whole verses out, you know, of the Bible. Acts 8:37, Mark 9:44, Mark 9:46. Whole verses out, gone. Oh, it's just minor differences. Read this again here. Overwhelming similarities between the surviving manuscripts in spite of a small percentage of variant readings, when brought together, give us an accurate reading. A record of God's word conveys to us that God has preserved his word and words in a remarkable fashion, and that God's word, which we possess today, maintains inspiration, inerrancy, and accuracy as it reflects the original writings he gave to us. Many times a position is misunderstood or either misstated without thinking through the theological repercussions and implications of it. While reading through many books on the textual and translation debate, I've come to the conclusion that various authors who actually do believe the Bible and defend it have made statements that would lead us to believe otherwise as they attempt to counter an opposing position and make their points regarding Bible preservation and inspiration. Though scholarly statements, lengthy discussions, and sometimes misunderstood conclusions, it seems that some fundamentalists have abandoned their trust in the Bible that they possess today. I don't think this is often the case, but it is sometimes perceived this way, as various authors seek to champion a certain position regarding Bible manuscripts and preservation. Let me state it in a simple fashion, cut through the thousands of pages of intricate debate. If our Bible that we possess today is not inspired and it cannot be trusted, then we no longer have any foundation. And of course, he quotes King James Bible here, but he doesn't believe it's God's word. It's kind of funny. He's actually condemning himself. All Bible-believing Christians realize that we can trust the Bible since we believe that God has preserved and inspired his words and truth through the overwhelming manuscript evidence that we possess today. Furthermore, we can also believe that God's word is still inspired and without error in the Bible translation we hold in our hand and use today, since it reflects worthy and circulating manuscript evidence and tradition which has passed down to us through the church centuries. To reject inspiration and copies of manuscripts and also in the Bible translation that we have today, keep saying the Bible translation, but he doesn't define what it is. is to align oneself with old-line liberalism and modernistic beliefs regarding the Bible and inspiration. God has not called us to be a Bible doubter, but a Bible believer. Let us remember this. Boy, it sounds good, doesn't it? Bible translations and inspiration. We often hastily conclude that the issue of inspiration does not apply to Bible versions in any way. If this were actually true, then none of us possess the inspired Word of God in the Bible translation that we use. It's true that the translators were not carried along by the Spirit as the original writers of Scripture, but it's equally true that we can't use this truism to deny the inspiration of our Bible, which we hold in our hands today. The text was carried along through the ages. Think of this. The preservation of Scripture has no practical relevance if it does not extend and apply to Bible translations. If a Bible translation cannot be equated with the actual Word or words of God, then we must travel to countries all over the world, search for God's truth in museums where manuscript artifacts are stored, and compare 5,656 documents every time we choose to translate a verse from the Greek or understand a verse in our Bible translation. Does any professor, preacher, or student of God's Word actually follow such a procedure? No, nor can we as preachers and laymen. You know, I gotta love the little, priest class and the laity there. So let's stop all of the talk about not possessing God's inspired Word in the Bible version that we use and study. Doesn't define which one, of course. It makes no sense to conclude that we cannot possess God's inspired Word in our translation. Personal preference is your God. Basically, you make your own mind up. There is no absolute truth. In other words, there's no absolute standard. You just decide what is your personal preference. In fact, when you stop and analyze this conclusion, it's downright unbelief. Oh boy, yeah, preach it, brother. Yeah, sure. Again, it's proper to conclude that no translators were inspired when putting together a specific translation, but it's quite another thing to conclude that our Bible is not inspired. In spite of what some neglect to teach, preservation of words in text types, we know from God's promise, 1 Peter 1:24-25, that he would keep his word from defilement and destruction. How can something be trusted which is not preserved? Okay. And by the way, I have that circled there and highlighted, because if you look up this, actually, let me do that real quick, just to show you the lying here. Trying to get through this thing quickly, but you know, there's, like I said, this is going to be a little bit more detailed because I have to show some of this stuff. Just to show you the lying nature of these types of guys. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 24 through 25. Now you see here he says, we know from God's promise that he would keep his word, capital W. 1 Peter, King James Bible, 24 and 25. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word, lowercase w, of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the lowercase w word, which by the gospel is preached unto you. So he lies right in his book, capitalizes the word, the W there. Deception. And of course, you know, like I said, even if you say, well, it's just he's trying to reverently, you know, communicate about the word. He's, you know, capitalizing the word. He doesn't believe in the King James Bible being perfect. We'll see that later. We also observe from personal history that God's people would be guided in the truth, and that God's word would be preserved as a document of truth and double an absolute standard. Well, for him, it would be a double standard. As God's people defend its content and doctrine, this defense of Scripture, the faith, Jude 3, would not only occur by maintaining what it said through theological debate and preaching, but out of necessity it would be maintained through the transmission of the text words of Scripture and proper textual criticism through the church centuries. This would result in God's word, again, here at the text, lowercase, there's God's word again, being accurately passed down from one generation to the next and preserved for us today in the manuscripts and Bible version that we use. Preference, personal preference. In other words, this transmission process has occurred so inspired words and doctrinal preaching could be passed down from one generation to the next. The transmission process took place so preachers today can still hold their Bible in hand and say, thus saith the Lord. What if your Bible doesn't say, thus saith the Lord? What if it's a new version, it takes out thus and saith? Well, let's not say that because that might offend those new version people. Yeah. No matter what side of the issue one falls regarding manuscript and manuscripts and translations, as fundamentalists, we must avow that we do possess God's Word and words. If you're using an American Standard Version, New American Standard Version, English Standard Version, whatever, you don't possess God's words. You possess a satanic counterfeit. So no, you can't stand up there and say, I possess God's inspired word. No, you don't. If you're using anything but a King James Bible for English-speaking people, you don't have God's word. Simple. It's very easy, you know, when you're honest. When you write these little booklets and stuff and you're a lying hypocrite, well, then you got to write a whole lot of stuff to try and get through what you want to say. I mean, I can just stand and, you know, sit here in front of you and just say, King James Bible, this one here, this is God's inspired and inerrant, infallible, perfect word of God. You don't need anything else. There you go. Use it. Simple. I'm done. I don't need to write a little booklet trying to weasel out of this position. Let's continue. We must also reconfirm that we can trust God's word today because it is inspired, inerrant, and infallible guide for truth, morals, and good godly living. May I remind all of us as fighting fundamentalists, look at that. If we conclude we don't possess God's words, so we're back to, you know, here's his word, there's his words. Confusion. God's not the author of confusion, by the way. And truth today and the Bibles that we hold in our hands, this would be an act of heresy. Oh boy. God's people down through the centuries have always believed that they possessed God's inspired word in the copies they read and studied. How can I preach God's word if I don't have God's word? So, you know, and you're going to see in the letter, he's like, well, I'm just trying to show reverence for the written word of God. Then why put lowercase here and capital there? How can I believe the truth if I don't have truth? Let's stop hiding behind the original manuscripts talk and start reassuring our people that God's word is not lost and that we can have confidence in the Bible that we preach from and use in our ministry. What Bible? Doesn't clarify. In addition, let us stop confusing our sheep with statements that downplay preservation. Yes, we should read and study about manuscript evidence and know about some of the variant readings, but let's stop hiding behind the veil of scholarly talk and reaffirm to ourselves and people that we do possess God's inspired and inerrant word today and can trust the Bible. Let's preach maximum certainty to our people and not create an environment of uncertainty and doubt regarding God's word. Okay. And we're going to see later on, he's shooting himself in the foot. It's actually kind of funny. He does the exact thing that he's condemning right there. It's rather disturbing today when I hear some fundamentalists throwing around the lingo of better manuscripts, older manuscripts, and the best manuscripts when speaking about the inspiration of the Bible. Let's stop hiding behind these manuscripts' smokescreens, which cause the average Christian to doubt their Bible is God's Word. Even variant readings should never cause us to doubt God's intent to give us His words. And His desire for us to possess all the words that He spoke. To only assign inspiration to manuscripts dating from the 4th and 5th centuries or any set of manuscripts, and not ascribe inspiration to our Bible today is a mockery of God's promise to preserve His Word. Yeah. And is a departure from historic Christian belief in the preservation of copied Scripture and the whole process of Bible transmission. I know you're impressed by all this. I'm sure. The Scriptures and the originals. It's sometimes assumed that the Bible usage of the word Scripture has only reference to the original autographs. However, virtually each time the word is used, it is referring to the copies of the Scriptures which people possess. Now, of course, that's true. And see, you know, here's how the lying hypocrites work. They mix truth with error. They do it all the time. You look at Satan, whenever Satan shows up in Scripture, he'll quote God. He'll quote God's word, but he'll mix in a little bit of error. You got to watch that. And of course, you can just, I'm not going to read all these different, you know, references to Scripture here. You can read these. I mean, that's what the Bible teaches, you know, but for sake of time, we're not going to go through these. You know, because the Bible, when the Bible talks about Scripture, it is talking about copies. Certainly. You know, there's one of the best ones right there, that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures. You know, that's referring to copies. Timothy did not have the original autographs. Okay, there you go. These verses show clearly that the word Scripture refers to what the people had access to, what was at hand, what was current. what they could then actually read and hear. In other words, they regarded handed down copies of the originals as scripture. Therefore, the Bible usage of the word scripture refers primarily to copies rather than the original autographs. Again, that's fine, that's true. The fact that these copies are called scripture strongly implies that God's people believed in textual preservation and that the very likeness of the inspired original writings had been passed down to them. The copies are holy, the copies are true, the copies cannot be broken, the copies are worthy of belief. God's people have always believed that the copies they possessed, read, and studied were the very voice of God. This can be shown by a comparison of the following verses. Consider several of them. Okay, and again, you can see these scriptures. We're not going to go through this. This is fine. This is quoted scripture. Okay, these verses and many others establish the important fact that there is no difference between God speaking through the original scriptures and God speaking through the copies of scripture. In these Bible references, the scriptures refer to that which is current and available. Therefore, it follows that our copies are as much the voice of God as the original documents. To deny this is to deny what all Bible-believing saints have accepted throughout the Old and New Testaments. That there was confidence and reassurance that God's word and words, there you have that weird thing again, were preserved and true. What is even more convincing is the same scriptures that were inspired in the past are profitable for us in the present. Okay, yes, that's all fine and good and fine and dandy and everything. But the fact of the matter is, in the first century, they weren't dealing with a whole set of corrupted copies of scripture and ones that were true. I mean, there were a couple instances. Let me show you an instance here where, you know, there were a couple statements made saying that people were making corrupted copies. That was there. I'll show you a good one here. Okay, here we have 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2, says that ye be not soon shaken in mind, nor be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. There were people that were writing faked copies of scriptures and signing Paul's name to it. So, yeah, there were false scriptures back then. But see, this whole debate here, you know, all we can prove, see that, you know, scriptures and things like this, you know, that, you know, they were to accept the scriptures that they had. Yeah, but something happened since that first century time. Since the first century, we now have a complete line of corrupted manuscripts over here. Less than 1% of the manuscripts are over here, and yet almost all of the modern, you know, well, I shouldn't say almost all of the modern Bibles produced since 1881 are based on this corrupted text that comes from the Vatican. Only the King James Bible in our modern usage today comes from this side over here, the side that goes back to Antioch. Read Acts chapter 11, where they were first called Christians. They were called Christians in Antioch, not Alexandria. So something happened since the first century. So to go back and say, see, the first century Christians, they just accepted the scriptures that they had as inspired, so we should do the same today. Whoa, 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 hold on a second there. Something happened from then until now. Now there's a whole set of corrupted manuscripts, corrupted copies of scriptures that the Vatican has brought down through the centuries and that they still use with their versions. All right? But let's continue. Here he quotes 2 Timothy 3:16. Yes, the original scriptures were inspired. However, Paul affirms that copies of these original scriptures would be profitable for readers of future centuries, including Timothy. Why? It's because transmission would keep inspiration intact. Timothy was no doubt raised on copies, and yet Paul also calls them scripture and then links them to original inspiration. In short, profitability has to do with the present scriptures we possess and love today because they are inspired. In fact, both past inspiration and present inspiration are joined together in an identical grammatical construction. Paul is saying that the work of past inspiration makes the scriptures profitable in the present since inspiration has been preserved. Past inspiration is inseparably linked to present inspiration and profitability. Not totally true, because again, he's omitting the fact that something happened since the first century. So to say what they were saying about scripture back then, accepting the scriptures, we can apply it to today, saying it doesn't matter what manuscript position you take or what Bible translation you use, we can still hold to the fact that they're inspired. That's not true. That's lying. That's deception. That's deceit. I'm going to show you more of it. Here we go. Here's my point. As fundamentalists, we should be able to stand up and boldly say without apology, the Bible I have in my hand today is God's Word, and I believe that God has preserved His Word for us today, that it is still inspired and inerrant, and that we can trust the Bible and receive it as God's absolute standard and truth for our lives today. 1 Thessalonians 2:13, he quotes it, and it's lowercase w, but up here it's uppercase w. Yeah. Although we are not apostles handing out and preaching the original inspired documents, we too must adopt the same attitude and respect toward the copies of Scripture as other Christians have done in the early days of Christianity, as copies were being disseminated throughout the churches. In essence, to refuse to ascribe preservation, inspiration, and inerrancy to manuscript copies of God's Word and to even Bible translations as they reflect God's accurate manuscript. Records passed down to us throughout the centuries is to deny something that no other Christian has denied throughout the history of Christianity. In fact, to deny that we don't have God's words and truth today in Hebrew and Greek texts, which reflect the original writings, and in Bible translations that accurately reflect these ancient texts, is to be an infidel. Okay, now here again, once you learn the way that these little scholars will do this, they will say, I believe that the King James Bible is God's preserved word as it accurately is translated. And you go, what was that second part? Oh, I believe it's God's word. Just shut up. Don't ask any more questions. Wait a second. As it is accurately translated. In other words, that leaves a little loophole for the scholar to come in and say, yes, it's God's word, except for a few places where I could point out it'd be better translated. More accurately translated to, you know, the manuscripts that I believe in and the Greek text that I feel comfortable with using and the definitions of Greek words that I prefer. You see. Now, I believe the King James Bible is perfect and inspired and inerrant as it stands, without any need to go to Greek or to Hebrew or whatever else. That's what I believe. You say, I don't believe it. Okay. Then use whatever you feel like using and just lie and be a hypocrite, because you can't come out and say, I don't believe God's word exists for us today in a perfect form, because you're never going to be able to witness to anybody doing that. And God will never use you. But let's continue. 2 Corinthians 6:15 asks, what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? It is unbelief, skepticism, and a travesty of God's word to deny its inspiration even in the Bible translation that one uses for ministry. To only assign inspiration to the original manuscripts or even to the manuscripts that we possess today while refusing to assign inspiration to our Bible is not a statement of a scholar, but of a scoundrel. Hung himself again. Who no longer believes that the common folks have God's word because of trying to sound scholarly all the time, you might just sound like an infidel. Hello, Kelly Sensenig, infidel. Bible believers, yay, let's read this. Beloved, let's be very careful about talking about inspiration in the original manuscripts and send a message that we don't possess God's words. Again, what's the jumping between capital and lowercase w? All the time. Jumping between words. What's the deal, man? Be consistent. We don't possess God's words and truth for us today in the Bible that we love and hold in our hands. Are we still Bible believers, or have we become Bible doubters? Fundamentalists must continue to believe in the transmission, and providential preservation of Scripture, so that they might assign inspiration and inerrancy to Scripture, even to the translation that they use, as it accurately reflects text, traditions, which are trustworthy, reliable, and which were in common usage. Oh, there you go. The old statement of the scholar, the scribe. You know, when the Bible talks about Jesus spake as one having authority and not as the scribes are constantly changing. And, well, that reading could be better stated. Yes, I agree. But why couldn't we refer to this manuscript over here, which better translates it as this? But yes, I believe that the word could be better translated as such. And they don't have any authority but themselves. We should possess a Bible-believing attitude, not a Bible-doubting attitude, toward the Bible that we use today, even if we disagree about certain manuscripts and the particulars about some verses in various translations. Yeah, okay. Jack Mormon comments on translations. When a translation is being prepared in accordance with the will of God, the life-giving breath of God will be felt in that translation. God's work of preservation does more than keep the Bible from error in its transmission and translation. It gives to the Bible an enduring freshness. This conclusion is Bible-believing. It honors the Bible that we have in our hands as God's Word and does not send confusing messages, like this book, regarding inspiration, inerrancy, and the preservation of God's Word as only applying to the original manuscripts. Let's face the facts. All Bible-believing fundamentalists will conclude that God's Word is not lost in Bible translations or uninspired. To claim that the inspiration only applies to past documents of ancient history or to the many piecemeal Greek documents we have today is to jettison the very foundation upon which fundamentalism is built, which is the Bible. Furthermore, to categorically deny the verbal inspiration of the Bible that we possess today places us in the category of liberalism and the camp of neo-orthodoxy, which rejects the inspiration and accuracy of the Bible. Again, it doesn't matter which translation. You could use any translation, just call it the Bible. You know, sure. For the love of God's enduring word, let's stop talking about inspiration as only being applicable to the original manuscripts or older manuscripts and start talking about inspiration of the Bible we love and use today. The remarkable agreement among thousands of existing ancient manuscripts confirms that the Bible has been providentially preserved in every generation as a document of truth that accurately reflects the originals. Therefore, we can say that the Bible we have is inspired, God-breathed, inerrant, free from error, infallible, incapable of error, because it accurately... Who judges whether it's accurately translated? See, that's up to the old scholar there. Follows the autographs. God did not rob us of the Bible or shortchange us, as some might suggest, by ascribing inspiration to only the original documents. God has not given to us second-rate, semi-inspired truth that was discovered somewhere in a secondhand store. The Lord has blessed us with the Bible, God's holy word, you know, lowercase h there, but, you know, capital W, whatever. Therefore, we should not downplay the accuracy or inspiration of our Bibles today. Bibles. Doesn't matter what you use, like he said earlier. Though, through some scholarly talk, which claims inspiration can only be attributed to the original manuscripts, better manuscripts, or Alexandrian manuscripts. Now, let me just stop for a minute here because I need to say this. I've been talking about this with the Steven Anderson study. I'm just going through this thing as it is because I really don't have time to go through and cut up, you know, and say, okay, I'm just going to do this part and that part, and leave this out and that out and stuff. But you see, the way a false prophet works is they'll put in so much filler material. I mean, this thing does not need to be a, how many pages is it here? A 23 page booklet. You don't need 23 pages to just simply say that the King James Bible is inspired. Of course, he never does say that. You know, you don't need all this writing and writing and writing and writing and writing. False prophets will throw in a few lies and then they put a whole bunch of filler in. That's a lot of it's true. But they confuse you with all this stuff and all this talk and what and you end up coming away going, oh, you know. It's a spirit of confusion. But I'm doing this as a way that I can show young believers, this is how you spot a hypocrite. Continuing, page 16. Instead, we should believe what the Bible says is true, cherish it, honor it, defend it. How do you defend a Bible without attacking others? Weird. Follow it and convey through these positive messages to one another, our congregations and children, since we are to be Bible-believing Christians, not merely original manuscript, Sinaiticus, Vaticanus, or received majority text Christians. You know, the Bible, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. You know, the B-I-B-L-E there. I'm still singing it. However, some want to change the old children's song and update it for more, or for modern times and scholarship, you know. And he makes a little funny thing there, you know. But of course, if as long as you believe in it, then it's okay. You're still a fundamentalist. Sure. Admittedly, these words are a bit hard for the children to sing at Bible school. I won't comment on that. Beloved, let's stop parading our prejudices before others and causing God's people to doubt God's word, which we hold in our hands today. This rebuke goes for both sides. those who follow a received majority text base, and those who follow a more critical text base. Okay. Yes, there are differences between the text types that we must address in the preservation manuscript translation debate, and after knowing the differences, take our stand. So be it. But let's possess a good disposition in the debate and stop calling fellow fundamentalists heretics and apostates. But they are heretics if they're using the new versions. If you're using a new version that traces back to the Vatican that has slaughtered millions, tens of millions of Christians down through the centuries, the Vatican that is condemned in Revelation chapter 17 and 18, you are a heretic if you're using one of those new versions. The new versions that specifically disobey commands to not change God's word. But let's not call people that use the new versions apostates and heretics. Yeah. What all fundamentalists must do and will do is reaffirm their belief in the verbal plenary inspiration of the Bible, stop attributing inspiration to only the original manuscripts, stop relating inspiration to only the concepts and doctrines of the Bible, and apply inspiration to the very words that they possess in their Bibles today. When doing this, fellow fundamentalists will get back to calling one another Bible believers, even though we might disagree on particulars regarding manuscript evidence. Oh, isn't that just so wonderful? I mean, I feel so warm and fuzzy right now. I mean, I feel like sitting down at a campfire, roasting marshmallows with my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ within the Catholics and within the Lutherans and within the Presbyterians and the Anglicans and the Episcopalians. Why are we fighting? Let's all join together. Let's not fight anymore. I mean, you know, make me puke. Ugh. Give me a break. And see, the very movement of Antichrist is eliminate differences. We're all fundamentalists. We all, you know, let's just all come together. Let's just everybody come together. Let's just, you know, stop fighting. Don't say, this is God's word, the others are fake. Oh, no. Don't do that. Let's not even go to the Receptus and the Alexandrian thing and make division over that. Let's bring unity. I don't think so. I would rather die than unify with the Catholics or their satanic, corrupt Alexandrian text. And I'm going to call their new version satanic because that's what they are. Continuing, Bible preservation and doubting Thomas. John Bergen wrote, if you and I believe that the original writings of the scripture were verbally inspired by God, then of necessity they must have been providentially preserved through the ages. Let's be honest, when all the smoke and debris of linguistic lingo regarding better, older, more reliable Byzantine majority and Sinaiticus, Atticus, Vaticanus, Alexandrian manuscripts clears, we should all come to the same conclusion as fundamentalists. We must still believe in the verbal inspiration of the Bible that we hold in our hands and should never doubt its authenticity and accuracy as a worthy reflection of the original writings. Personal preference. Ye can be as gods. If Satan wrote a book, it would be like this. I guarantee it. It's disgusting. No fundamental preacher would ever think of standing up before his people with Bible in hand and say, this is not God's word. I can't trust it. I cannot be sure about the inspiration of its words and message since I don't have the 5,656 manuscripts before me. And since I can't travel to the museums all over the world, which house these manuscripts and accurately compare them, of course, this type of conclusion is unbelieving. It also lacks common sense since the Bibles we possess today are an accurate reflection of these manuscripts. Okay, actually, my King James Bible is not an accurate reflection of Vaticanus, Sinaiticus, and the other corrupted satanic Greek texts. Let's continue. If we reject applying inspiration to manuscripts and our Bibles, we might as well join the liberal and modernist club. We are no better than the liberals. The alleged scholarly confusion of many today goes something like this. Pristine autographs, flawed copies, flawed Bibles, incomplete inspiration and preservation, but no doctrine lost, close enough, no harm done. I must admit this is a rather bizarre way to view God's eternal truth. I am not a member of the Doubting Thomas Club, for I am certain that God has preserved his word as he promised in thousands of surviving manuscripts that present the same witness. So it's not, I am confident that God has preserved his word and made this English translation of it so I can read it and believe it and preach it and teach it. Oh no, he won't stand for the King James Bible. Not in this. Now he'll come out and I prefer the King James Bible. But we're going to see in the final letter that he wrote back to me that he doesn't believe the King James Bible is perfect and inspired and inerrant. He doesn't believe it. Preservation refers to the providential keeping of the original text from loss and alteration throughout the centuries of time, so the words, meaning, and teaching of the Bible cannot be changed. Gives a bunch of references there. The above verses either directly or indirectly teach preservation. Let me reiterate, a Bible cannot be trusted when its words are not preserved for us. It seems senseless to fight against preservation unless one wants to avoid a certain text, type, or placed out upon the inspiration of their Bible today. New Testament writers refer to the Old Testament texts of Scripture, gives a bunch of things there, indicating their confidence in the preservation of the words and text of Scripture. These passages provide historical proof that the Old Testament has been preserved unto the New Testament period without placing confidence in its accurate transmission. Their hope would have been misplaced. The attitude of the early church was that God would preserve his word for them, and any other attitude was unbelieving and critical of God's promise and intended purpose regarding Scripture. Without the providence or superintendence of God over the copying and maintaining of a biblical text, we could not have the Scriptures in a completed form today. We would not know that what Jesus really taught and said regarding the gospel and eternal life. God's providence was seen throughout history, and in particular phases of history, we see God's working behind the scenes, not recreating inspiration, but directing men to record God's preserved words accurately. The preservation of God's sacred text should be included in the study of bibliology. We should all agree that inspiration was a one-time act of God, but preservation was a process God used to protect his word throughout the ages. The believing proposition that God has preserved his word and words progressively and providentially throughout the ages involves both fact and faith as it relates to manuscripts and translations. Okay, so again, we're seeing this whole thing. Yes, they believed in inspiration of Scripture and everything back there in the first century, so we can too today. But what about the corruption that came in? What about the corruption of the Nestle's text? What about the corruption of these Alexandrian family of manuscripts? And many of the new versions had departed even from the Alexandrian readings. Many of the new versions are putting in feministic, gender-inclusive language that has no manuscript support at all. But as long as you hold it in your hands and you're a fundamentalist, you know, it's inspired. It's inspired by virtue of your belief. You are God. You decide whether it's inspired or not. Continuing, although man was not perfect in recording God's words through the copying of manuscripts and printing process, God has providentially overruled the human element of imperfections, mistakes, and errors, not by eliminating them, but maintaining his words in spite of them. God overruled various glitches, little bit of doubt there, and errors in the transmission process in order to maintain and preserve his original words. In addition, because these texts have been accurately recorded and reflected in our Bibles, we can conclude that the Bible is inerrant, without error, infallible, incapable of error, and inspired verbally to every word and plenary equally and entirely. Okay, keep saying, I mean, he's just going over the same thing over and over and over again, putting in things that are true, but all this error mixed in with it. This is the way false prophets write. That's why I'm showing you in this study. Continuing, in spite of the position we take on Hebrew and Greek manuscripts as fellow fundamentalists, we should advocate maximum certainty regarding Bible preservation and inspiration and not become a doubting Thomas in the area of Bible preservation and inspiration as it relates to our Bibles. God has not left us in the dark regarding his word. Because of the biblical statements regarding preservation and the historical records and roots of textual transmission, along with the thousands of Greek manuscripts we do possess, we should accept the Bible as his inspired word for us today. God's word and words have not been lost through translation. They are accurately reflected in our Bible, which has been translated from inspired manuscripts passed down through the transmission process. Since this is true, we should not relegate God's words and truth to only the original manuscripts that the apostles and early church possessed, to manuscripts uncovered in the sands of Egypt, or to the thousands of other ancient manuscripts of antiquity. What good are the original manuscripts if we no longer have an accurate reflection and replica of them in the Bibles, in the Bible that we possess? What good are the thousands of manuscripts if they are not reflected in our Bible? Just about done. No re-inspiration, double inspiration has ever occurred with a certain text type. Look at this little jab at the King James or specific Bible translation, 1611 King James English. Look at that little jab at the King James Bible right there. That's a spirit coming out of him. King James English, Elizabethan. And you're going to see later on in his letters, he has an attitude about it. At any given point in history, quote scriptures there, although we reject the theory of re-inspiration in Bible translations and Greek texts, we also reject the notion that inspiration is lost after the original documents were given. Inspiration is passed down through the centuries and thousands of manuscript copies that God, in his providence, has given to us through the history of the church. Furthermore, it's these same manuscripts that are reflected in our Bible today. To deny the inspiration of our Bible is to say that our Bibles cannot be trusted, that liberalism was right in denying the inspiration of the Bible, and that God has not preserved his word and words for us today. Whose side are you on? We should be on the Lord's side. Draw a line in the sand and stand behind your Bible. See the personal preference again? And preach God's truth. God's truth is your personal preference. With reassurance, commitment, and confidence that inspiration was not lost through the centuries, but was passed on to us through the thousands of Greek texts and Bibles which God has, in his providence, has used to keep and preserve his word, any other conclusion is riddled with unbelief and liberal dogma. Well, I agree, and that's certainly you, Kelly Sensenig. And here he, you know, quotes some lines from this old hymn here. You can read that if you want. As fundamentalists, let us stay fundamental. Let's stop acting like God has shortchanged us today and we no longer possess God's inspired word and words. The inspiration of God's word is not merely assigned to the original documents, it's also applied to our Bible today through the process of historical transmission and preservation. God's truth and word is not merely out there in the thousands of surviving manuscripts or back there only in the originals, it is in our Bible. And all the Bible-believing, fighting fundamentalists said, amen, amen, brother. Oh, yeah, yeah, wow, I'm just so thrilled and inspired by this disgusting vomit. You know, it's in our Bible. Where's that one section at here? I'm trying to find it. Yeah. Here, again, page 3 of this dumb thing. He says American Standard Version or some other Bible translation. And back here, you know, it's in our Bible. So, personal preference. That's all that he really stands for here. He's teaching people to be liars. You can stand up. You can use the Nestle's text. You can use the Textus Receptus. You can use the King James Bible. You can use American Standard Version, English Standard Version, whatever, and just stand there and say, this is God's preserved word. It's inspired, it's infallible, it's inerrant, it's this, it's that, it's whatever, as long as it accurately reflects the text. He's not taking any stand at all. He is preaching liberalism.